Good morning, friends. Today is fourth session of this series, video series, where we are going to discuss happy hypoxia syndrome. Now, all of us have come across cases where the patient is hypoxic but well and suddenly collapses. So this puzzling phenomena we'll try to explain based on our pathogenesis. So what is happy hypoxia syndrome? Happy hypoxia syndrome is a situation where the patient is apparently well. Patient is not having any distress. There is no tachypnea. Saturation is low. He's laughing, talking. Sometimes the patient visits the restroom and strains. And in the restroom itself, patient collapses. Some unfortunate events already has happened. Now this happy hypoxia, what is the pathophysiology basis behind it? So, till now we are telling T cell, C cell, we thought that it may be our imagination. It may not be true. But a convincing evidence has come from Italian series of postmortem electron microscopy, where pneumocyte type 2, specifically pneumocyte type 2, were found teeming with virion particles, just like COVID. So there is a proof that pneumocyte type 2 is the target. Now, how this P-type COVID actually leads to happy hypoxia? That is the question that we'll deal in this particular session. So, classical description of this is it happens suddenly. Patient is well, suddenly collapses. But as a caregiver, we know that suddenly nothing happens in life, nothing happens in ICU, nothing happens in interpersonal relationships. Nothing happens in international relationships also. A classical example of this recently is our relationship with our neighbor. Look at the left side. There is a stone, big stone. So this big stone is a butterball stone in Mahabalipuram, in our state of Tamil Nadu. Now, when we deal with corona, we are initially happy. We think that this particular problem is actually quite okay. Manageable. And suddenly what happens, we know. So we have to be careful. Don't go at face value of corona. We should understand that even if the patient is looking happy, patient is hypoxic. For any sudden worsening, when we introspect and when we analyze and prevent it in future, but to divide this sudden worsening into certain stages. What are the stages? First stage is background of this. What is the background? Then what happens is buildup happens. The situation is actually not very bad, but slowly it is building up. Then it leads to mini events, not mega, small events. There are prodromal events, which tell us that things are not okay. After that, there is apparent well-being comes up. Then the big event happens. And then effect of event happens. And the patient crashes. Let us go one by one. What is the background? Background is P-type COVID. In previous talk, we understood what is P-type COVID. P-type COVID is nothing but pneumocyte type 2 COVID. Pneumocyte type 2, which is lining the alveolar wall, is affected and is dysfunctional. Now this, what is function of this pneumocyte type 2? To maintain the integrity of alveolar membrane. And then a cascade of events starts. First of all, what happens is that because of surfactant deficiency, partial collapse of alveoli. Water and cell go inside. They liberate leukotrienes. Since they liberate leukotrienes, there is no local vasoconstriction. Means what? Blood supply to this useless alveolus is maintained unnecessarily. This is a wasted perfusion. So ideally, blood supply should be diverted here, but it doesn't happen. This useless alveolus continues to be perfused. Because of that, it leads to formation of small intrapulmonary shunts, and that leads to hypoxia. Now, this patient is not having distress, because distress requires encroachment on dead space of CO2, not O2. Now, CO2 diffusion is better than O2. So CO2 is not affected. No distress, no tachypnea, hypoxia early in course, fever of short duration, apparent well-being. So this is the background. Now what happens is that then a build-up happens. This is the most important slide. Very, very important slide. Let us see it carefully. What is the build-up of this P-type COVID? In this particular figure, these round, round circles are not alveoli. They are the pre-capillary arteries or pre-capillary arterioles of lung. So these pre-capillary arterioles at this point of time, they are open. They are actually doing very well. They are perfusing the all parts of lung. Now, in some parts of lung, there is a P-type COVID. This part of lung, P-type COVID. This part of lung, P-type COVID. This part of lung, P-type. Peripheries. In peripheries of lung, there is P-type COVID. And because it is P-type, there is no local vasoconstriction. Alveoli are partly collapsed, but these arterioles or these vessels are actually continuing to perfuse them. So they are dilated. They are unable to vasoconstrict appropriately. The word for this is local vasoplasia. Local vasoplasia is there. Now, because of this local vasoplasia, what happens is that blue blood continues to be blue and it returns to heart. Now it leads to mild to moderate hypoxemia. Now, ideally, this mild to moderate hypoxemia should be corrected, but it can't correct because this is vasoplasia. This hypoxia sets in second stage. That is, it leads to pulmonary vasoconstriction. Now, other arterioles also are constricting. So, this is arterially dilated, but it is going to useless alveoli. They are going to useful alveoli, but they are constricted. So, description is very, very clear. That generalized pulmonary vasoconstriction with local vasoplasia. Generalized pulmonary vasoconstriction with localized vasoplasia. Now this pulmonary vasoconstriction leads to hypoxia. Vasoplasia also leads to hypoxia. These two effects are additive. Now it leads to situation where comfortable hypoxia. Patient is comfortable, not arrhythmic. And this patient is having hypoxia. Now, that particular patient actually is experiencing something, but he or she doesn't understand the importance of it. When patient goes to restroom, and is straining at stools, or straining at urine, or when he's laughing, after talking, the patient complains about giddiness. Many patients you must have come across where they complain of giddiness. Suggestive of not syncope, but just pre-syncopal situation, or some chest pain. Or giddiness, but they think it is okay. Ringing in ears after talking on phone for a long time, loudly. Then what happens is the big event happens. What is this event? The event, if you see, straining at stools, laughing, talking, they are nothing but forceful expiration with completely or partially closed airways. So voluntary obstruction of airway with forceful expiration is causing this worsening. We call this, already we know it is Valsalva maneuver like situation. Valsalva maneuver, everybody knows that we close the nose, close mouth and try to exhale forcibly. Well, this Valsalva maneuver has been studied in detail. Let us go for some evidence in physiology and in articles which are already published. What happens in Valsalva maneuver? So, in this Valsalva maneuver, what happens is that a lot of changes are happening in heart rate and blood pressure. To understand this complex interaction, we'll go step by step. This horizontal line tells about time. In time, this is the start of Valsalva maneuver. After some time, we ask the patient to release it. This is the stop. Now, on vertical axis, there is systolic blood pressure. Now, we are going to monitor what happens to systolic blood pressure with time. Beginning and end of Valsalva maneuver, one by one. Now let us go for it. Initially, blood pressure is normal. At beginning of Valsalva, when the patient is actually laughing, talking, that is ultimately forcibly expiring air with partly closed airways. What happens initially? First is VP goes up. Blood pressure goes up. Why it goes up? This goes up because of squeezing of blood from lung to left atrium. You imagine you have taken deep inspiration. We are forcibly expiring against partially obstructed airway. Our lungs are squeezed. So this squeezing of lung transfers a lot of blood from lung to atrium extra, more and above the usual. This extra injection of blood leads to increase in blood supply. This is a very important defense mechanism in all the animals. You must have heard about the importance of spleen. When the horse, dog runs, the spleen contracts and it transfers a lot of blood to the running animal. You must experience yourself when you are pushing a car or lifting a heavy weight. What we do? We take a deep breath. Then we close our glottis. And then we push that particular car. And during pushing, we are slowly exhaling. So this additional blood which goes into circulation is called support of circulation by lung. This is the first step. Once you started Valsalva, blood pressure goes up. Second phase comes up. In second phase, what happens is because of this increased intrathoracic pressure, venous return from heart, venous return to the heart is reduced. Because of that, naturally, less blood in right side, less blood on left side of heart. Then BP comes down. Next stage comes up is to compensate for that, there is systemic vasoconstriction. BP again goes up. And now comes the most important phase in Valsalva, which is very important for us in COVID, that is drop in BP. What this drop in BP happens? This drop in BP happens because now we have released the Valsalva. Now we have released the pressure. Now things are expanding. Aorta dilates and pulmonary vessels also dilate. Because of this sudden dilation of pulmonary vessels, blood pools in lung. Because blood pools in lung, it can't come to left atrium and then left ventricle. So dilation of aorta and pulmonary vessels. Last is, because venous return is improving, now BP goes up. Now this particular increase in venous return sometimes overshoots. You must observe that this particular peak is taller than this peak. So this overshoot happens. This is the normal physiology of Valsalva. So now what happens when actually this particular thing is deranged? For example, before that, we'll come across what happens to heart rate. Now this heart rate usually is inversely proportional. When stroke volume reduces, cardiac output reduces. To maintain cardiac output, heart rate goes up. It is inversely proportional. We can get a fantastic compensation by body like this. When things are going up, heart rate goes down. BP falling, heart rate goes up. This is quite good compensatory mechanism. But the problem is actually here. Here now see, this BP has gone up, gone down, gone up, gone down. This is area where BP is actually low. And unfortunately, heart rate also coming down. So this low BP and low heart rate is the time when we have to be very, very careful. That is, not during Valsalva, but after Valsalva. After you laugh, after you talk loudly, after you strain, that is the time. And when you release the pressure, that is the time when blood pressure also low and heart rate also low. Now this particular situation is scary, dangerous, where heart rate is low, stroke volume is low. In addition to that, unfortunately, these COVID patients are already having diastolic dysfunction of left ventricle. Means left ventricle can constrict well, but can't dilate well. This particular phenomena will come in next presentation. But it's a dangerous phase 4 after laughing is over, after loud talk is over. After a few seconds, low heart rate, low BP, and ventricle can't actually dilate. Ventricle can't relax properly. This is the time these syncopal attacks and myocardial infarctions hit. Now, in addition to that, there is insufficient phase 1 because the squeezing of lung and support of circulation also is poor because of vasoconstriction and interpulmations. That we'll see in next. So, summary-wise, Valsalva maneuver is normal. The dangerous phase of Valsalva maneuver can be exacerbated by COVID. Now let us prepare one hypothetical. Previous graph was actually real graph from physiology textbooks. This graph is imagination. how we created this graph? First of all, what are the changes we saw? This particular thing has become blunted. This has become exaggerated. This has become exaggerated. BP is actually lower than usual. And heart rate also is lower than usual. Now this is a dangerous situation where the patient can get acute reduction in systemic blood supply. Most important is brain and heart, where the patient can have stroke, patient can have sudden myocardial infarction. Now, is it imagination? No. There is evidence that is actually happens in pulmonary arterial hypertension. This is a classical experiment actually done where the upper part of this graph is a normal. That is, this is blood pressure. Valsalva starts, pressure goes up, then goes down, again goes up, again goes down, and then overshoot happens and normalizes. This is called pressure recovery time. It is short. And nadir, that is lowest part, is also shallow. Now compare this with pulmonary vasoconstriction. What happens in pulmonary vasoconstriction? This phase 1 or stage 1 is very blunted. There is no big rise in BP. The fall is quite deep. Compare this distance with this distance. It is deep. BP is falling lower than usual. Recovery is poor. And most important, this is very, very deep. Compare this line with this line. So this hypotension at the end of Valsalva is significantly more in pulmonary arterial hypertension. This is known fact. And we also know that pulmonary vasoconstriction is hallmark in P-type code. Another important part is recovery time. Recovery time, if you see, is prolonged than this. This recovery time is very short. It came to baseline very quickly, but it took a long time. Now, this long time, during that period, brain and heart can suffer from hypoperfusion. So sudden stroke, sudden myocardial infarction is expected in COVID if they undergo Valsalva maneuver. Second situation, this is another beautiful study which showed what happens in PA4. As we know, patent foramen ovale is normally present in almost one-fourth of all of us. All of us are having patent foramen ovale almost one-fourth. So this PFO present and we are doing Valsalva, what happens? In that situation, what happens is that whenever we are doing Valsalva, this thorax is actually, when the pressure is more, then they try to find out whether heart contract systole is affected or diastolic affected. They came to know that direction in which the pressure is constricting the heart is such that this Valsalva will not affect the contraction, but will affect the relaxation. Again, the diastolic dysfunction. So now we imagine a COVID patient who is already having left ventricular diastolic dysfunction. Ventricles can't relax properly. Plus, superimposed on that, we are actually pressing them from outside. The ventricles can't relax. So ventricles can't accept blood from lung. When they can't accept blood from lung, in next few beats, they can't supply the body. So this end diastolic volume reduction, end diastolic area reduction, diastolic dysfunction of left ventricle is the hallmark of PFO. Now this PFO, is it really present in all? No, it is present in few. The problem is, in this particular situation, diastole is affected more than systole. Now we know the coronaries are perfused during diastole. So this is the recipe for myocardial infarction. So now we have got a left ventricle which is unable to dilate. We have got a very difficult diastole. Pressure is high and coronaries are actually being affected. Now this Valsalva is known to open the PFO. It is silent PFO is there. But during Valsalva, PFO opens. It is used as a test to diagnose the hidden PFO. Now, once PFO is opened, there can be paradoxic embolism. The normally occurring thromboembolic emboli in deep veins of lower limb, they can find its way into the left side of heart. And then stroke and myocardial, this is known fact. So, there are a number of ways in which a COVID patient, P-type, hypoxic, well, can suddenly collapse after Valsalva-like activities, after Valsalva is released. So summary. Now we are coming to the end of this particular short video. What is summary here? Is background, build up, mini events, event, effect of event, and crash. And then we'll go for how to prevent it and anticipate it. So background is very clear. It is P-type COVID. What is P-type COVID? No distress, no tachypnea, hypoxia, patient well. Already there is a lot of intrapulmonary shunts are happening. Background vasoconstriction is happening. Storage function is impaired. Multiple areas of paravasoplegic areas where the vessel can't constrict is dilated. Dilated vessel supplying the useless alveoli. Useful alveoli are at your constricted. Hypoxia is there. But patient is comfortable. Now this patient undergoes Valsalva-like activities. Now once we go for Valsalva-like activities, there is no rise in pressure, profound fall in blood pressure. If recovery does happen, then he releases Valsalva. And then profound fall in blood pressure along with lower heart rate is to so-called sudden low cardiac output. Now this cardiac output is low. And in susceptible patients, it can lead to syncope, it can lead to myocardial infarction, it can lead to stroke. Now the patient becomes unresponsive. Now, once we know this pathogenesis, the whole idea is not about treatment, it is about prevention. So how to prevent this particular unfortunate event in patient of COVID? First step is for frontline workers. Do not go by only apparent well-being. Every case of COVID or suspected COVID, we must oxygen saturation monitoring at community level. There's no shortcut for that. Now, this oxygen saturation monitoring will go a long way in picking up cases early. Second is watch for or ask for. Only watch for is not actually sufficient. Ask for it specifically. Many patients won't report it unless until we ask specifically. Giddiness after strangers too. Or after loud talk or after laughing, is the patient experiencing some chest pain or giddiness? If some chest pain or giddiness is there, then we have to anticipate this happy hypoxia and take measures appropriately. Measures are very easy. Just monitoring and avoiding the activities which precipitate. But that unfortunate patient is unaware of that. Then he worsens. Therapeutic implications. Avoid straining at stool. Don't strain at stool. Don't talk loudly for a long time. Many patients have died on talking on phone. They feel good, I'm good, and all those things. They talk with their family members, laugh. It's a lot of social interactions. And after that, they suffer from chest pain, giddiness, and they have collapsed. So don't strain at stool. Don't talk loudly for a long time. Don't laugh too much. Ultimately, no excessive social interaction. This is very important for caregivers. That if you find a patient of COVID who is oxygen dependent, suddenly collapsing, do not restate in supine position. Do not restate in proper position. Always keep the patient flat. Keep the patient flat so that blood supply to brain is improved. And then restate the patient. So I'll repeat these particular instructions again. What are therapeutic implications of this mechanism? Oxygen saturation monitoring is must in all cases. It is not optional or in selective cases. Must in all cases. Irrespective of apparent well-being. Identify P-type COVID early. Don't wait, because P-type COVID only mortality is very high compared to C-type. So identify P-type COVID early. Watch for or ask for giddiness after straining at stool or after loud talk or laugh. Avoid straining at stool. Avoid loud talk for a long time. Avoid laughing. Avoid excessive social interaction. And suppose unfortunately the patient collapses actually, instruct the sisters, don't keep the patient propped up. By keeping the patient propped up, actually we are doing more harm than good. Let the patient be supine. And in supine position, then you restate or oxygen, whatever it is. So these are the few messages I would like to communicate to everybody, including frontline workers, including ICU doctors, including patient community in general, so that we can avoid this sudden worsening and sudden collapse of this P-type COVID patients. Thank you. Thank you for patient listening. Next video, we are going to go for a very tricky situation, but common situation in COVID, that a patient is wheeled in. We are talking about P-type, C-type, but that doesn't work well in ER, emergency. We are not going to take history. The patient just comes up with features of both. Patient is having distress, patient is hypoxic. We start treating. We give oxygen. Patient transiently improves, then worsens. When we intubate, put on ventilator, patient transiently improves and crashes completely. These sudden, not sudden, but fast, rapid deaths after admission to hospital has become a really a challenge for the team. How to prevent these rapid deaths after admission of a COVID patient? This is our next discussion in next video. So thanks a lot for watching. Thank you very much.